Cool. You good, famous?
Everybody's cool.
Wow. Can you hear yourself?
Ooh, yes.
They're nice, huh?
It's lovely.
Very becoming.
Is this a particular EQ you use for Hawaii? Or
it's the Wakeling EQ, actually.
The Polynesian EQ.
It's a secret one. It is Dave Lawrence, and I'm hanging out here. I'm in one of the HPR studios with my buddy, Dave Wakeling.
That's right.
And from
aloha,
the
mates.
And aloha to you, brother.
Yeah. Brother, man.
It's a great thing to have you here, and I appreciate you taking a couple moments to come join us here in the studio.
Thank you very much, and it couldn't be a better preparation than visiting three or four of the nicest beaches, you know, just popping in, quick roll in the sand, quick dip or thinking of it, and then fell asleep on one.
Did you?
Terrific. Woke up with little speckles of rain. Explosions of liquid sunshine, I thought at the time. Now, the idea of falling asleep on a beach in England and waking up with rain hitting you and it being any sort of pleasurable experience is so remote that even if you were trying to think of an idea for a science fiction film in a pub,
it wouldn't work.
After closing, people would still laugh at you for that idea. But that's, I swear, is what happened.
Ooh, what about LA? Would that happen to you there?
No, not like that. Not like that. That rain was delicious. You know, and I only slept for probably 10 minutes, but I felt like I'd slept for 1,000 years. I was redeemed in many ways.
It's a great feeling falling asleep outside. I know exactly what you mean, because when you wake up, it's like, wow, I managed to fall asleep on this beach with all this noise and chaos around me. Do you have a little privacy up there with the turtles, or was it a lot of people on the beach?
There was quite a lot of people, and we felt sorry for some of them because they only had just about enough time to jump off a bus, take a picture of each other to verify the fact they were actually at that beach, and then back onto the next one.
And did you find on your previous visits to Hawaii, were you able to get out and see stuff like the turtles, or was this your first time getting to do that?
You get to see a little bit. It depends. I always try and make sure I get to see a bit, but this was the first time I'd seen really anything much outside of Honolulu. This island, all the times I've been to this island. So that was interesting and fascinating to me because it's more like an island that people live on.
Right.
Rather than people visit.
Than a vacation destination.
You know, yes, exactly. So you notice that difference straight away and that makes it even more interesting.
Sure. No question. It's the real life that people have here as opposed to a lot of visitors. I can relate to that. You know, when I think about the kind of cats who I knew when I was younger who were listening to your music and really adored it, skater scene was a part of the culture around in my high school as I got older that was really into it. And just out of curiosity, because I've always wondered this, especially when I look at videos of you, was when you were a kid, were there any activities like that? Were you a skater at all, or were there any activities like that that you got into?
There wasn't anything like that, as far as I remember. People were trying it, I think, with like LSD or psilocybin. They were simulating the effect of having wheels as you sped down the street or up walls even.
A bit frightening.
Very similar, I think, with a similar amount of swell bows from the attempts. No, we didn't have anything like that. We had, I remember we went on tour in Europe and we were shocked because just ordinary roller skating was a big deal. Whereas it wasn't in England at the time, we were aware of. So we all bought these hideous blue and yellow
roller skates.
And we used them going round and round in circles before soundcheck, as they set up everything. We would sometimes pretend we had our own ice rink.
Right.
You know, it was good.
And no skateboards?
No, I don't think I'd ever seen any.
Till America?
Yep.
Wow.
Yeah, I think that's it. Always at the cutting edge, you guys.
Well, it was like,
what is it with you fellas?
Crazy Yanks.
I know you could put a net on one end. You know, and then have 12-foot people have to jump over it to put a ball through it.
You should patent that.
You know,
could be a good idea. When did you gravitate to music? If it wasn't through activities like that, what was the thing that made you say to yourself, "I've got this gift"?
Oh, I don't know about that, but I know about gravitating to music, and I was always attracted for some reason, but the particular the welding to it came at about 12 or 13 as a competition swimmer. And if I won a medal, especially if it was a gold one, then as part of the celebration ceremony that my father kindly did, which meant stopping at a pub halfway between the swimming pool and home, which could be like 30 or 40 miles, you know, break up the journey, and he would go and drink 3 pints of beer very nicely and then drive me back, which was seen as being very responsible in those days, to break up the journey that way rather than do the full 40 miles without drinking anything, you know. If I'd won something, then I got to have the radio on and I got an orange pop.
Wow.
You're kidding me.
If you didn't win.
I'd sit in the dark and wait till he came out the pub with a couple of good insults. Or nothing. Jeez. Nothing. Not another word. Till you got home. Better get out then, eh?
No. Ooh. Question.
Whew. Tough there. They should make a movie about competition swim. Well, they probably did. Anyway, but if I'd won something, I got to listen to the radio and drink an orange pop, clutching my medals. And I heard Don't Walk Away, Renee by the Four Tops, followed by Ruby Tuesday by the Rolling Stones. Well, halfway through the Four Tops, I was already starting to shake a bit. It's not that, it's just the chlorine in my eyes. Okay, I'm not crying. Why are the hairs going up on your neck? And, up your, and then by Ruby Tuesday, I was done, sobbing. And I never realised how much of an effect music had on me until then. And it's had that effect on me ever since. And that's when I knew, well, I knew two things. I was getting sick of having my hair so burnt by chlorine that having my head shaved was actually the best of haircut choices. I was getting sick of that. And I like this music thing.
So it was an emotional pull, an emotional connection.
It was indeed, yeah. It really was.
What made you play? What made you say, you know, not only do I dig listening to it, do I get off on that, but made you say, I'm going to pick up a guitar?
Frustration, irritation, an inability to express yourself, banging your head against imaginary walls until you're sick of the size of bricks, you know? And so I learned to play the guitar upside down and back to front, tune it so it was in already a nice tuning, and then just play so it was sort of hypnotic. And ideas would come and ideas would go and some would stick. And, well, that's funny. Well, that's good. And the ideas would start to sound and resonate with the sounds on the guitar, and the two of them would match together. And you could do a song round and round for about an hour. Sometimes you'd got some bits worth keeping.
Right.
Sometimes it was a load of crap. But at least most times you didn't want to put your head through a window anymore. You didn't want to do anything that would make you break out in handcuffs.
So it really was a mellowing sort of force?
I suppose it was. No, it made you feel stronger by the end of it. It just, you didn't feel so irritated by the fact that reality didn't add up as it had been reported.
Right.
I've gone through these reports and
it doesn't match.
This doesn't add up.
Right.
This doesn't add up. Even on the World Service. I checked the World Service news at midnight. This bloody thing doesn't add up.
I like that. We were talking about that the other day. Our news gathering routines. We talked about this in the phone interview, which is, I think, one of the really fascinating things about you is the road didn't start with ska and reggae and incredibly infectious pop hooks that are hard to get out of your head. The road, what was the first bands? I know Sabbath, you said, was the first concert. When you say you were playing, little things were coming together on the guitar, coming together, kind of coalescing, if you will, as a musician. What was the stuff you were inspired by to play?
Well, I liked the local bands because you liked local things, like you liked your local football team, you know. And it wasn't bad that Black Sabbath and Led Zeppelin happened to be the local bands. Local lads, just about to, you know.
Make it big.
So that was good. They were something local that you could champion.
And so you liked them both a lot.
I did. always a little bit suspicious about the over-reliance on black magic symbolism with Black Sabbath. With a name like Black Sabbath, I suppose, that would tip you off, right? But I did worry about that a bit. It was like, hey, I wonder if flirting with that sort of stuff, you know. I mean, look, it made Aldous, what's his name?
Aldous Huxley?
No, I'm sorry, that's the wrong person, isn't it? The Beast, what was his name? Aleister Crowley.
Oh.
I mean, it made him look pretty weird, and he took it serious, didn't he? You know, so he wasn't even messing about with it. So you did worry for them, for plucky West Midlanders.
It was serious stuff back then, is what you're saying. It wasn't just like a bit like today. I mean, you messed with that back then, it was a very...
Well, it was a serious thing, but they seemed to be fairly...
Loose with it.
Flippant, right. I think was the word. So I'm not sure. So that sort of spoiled it, but the other stuff was good.
It's just such a long road from when I watch you dancing around singing I Confess. You know, it's like, and the thing about that is, when I look at you doing that, to me... It's a very mature kind of lyrics. It's the kind of stuff that you have to kind of be a little bit older to make sense of. I was kind of impressed that at that point you were able to do...
Precocious lyric, wasn't it? Yeah, no, I've had to live it now. That's one of the sad things about being a smartass in the first half of your life, is that you're often forced to live it. Exactly as if it was some sort of prediction, premonition. And so you do live out quite a lot of this. And I think it's natural because you're stirring away at the stuff that's in the subconscious there. You're stirring away at mud, aren't you? You know, getting into a hypnotic trance with the groove of a song, and lyrics and ideas are suggesting themselves as fit into the mood that you're in. And so it's probably giving you hints and glimmers of what's going on underneath there. And... which, of course, you pay blithely no attention to at all, till it turns into a crisis in later years. And it's good because there's a record of it there, much like a Sumerian clay chart. It's just like, well, look, Wakeling, you were saying there, it's drift gently into mental illness. I mean, you predicted it yourself, good God. Well, I can't believe you're whining about it now. This is driving me mad. You said that. You said it was going to. So some of that, and it's funny, until you think people might be watching, and then it's horrifying.
Well, there's two ways to look at that, too, though, because the same thing you're saying, as a fan, when you're young, you could appreciate it on one level. When you're a lot older and you've been through things and you listen to it, you can appreciate it on another level. It's like...
Well, yes, I think as well, because apart from thinking that you're going to be immortal, you also think that you're not... woundable to the point where you'll limp forever. You know, when you're young, you cut your finger and the next day you can already see the healing process.
You're resilient. Right?
Beginning. Right. You know what I mean? Not even more than resilient. You renew quickly, don't you? You know, you scrape the front of your the bow and like, what do you call it, your calf, your shin. Scrape your shin when you're a teenager or something, and by the next week, you can't remember which shin it was that you'd scraped. You scrape your shin in your 50s, you know, it's like, you're still looking at it at Christmas. Is that still there?
Right.
Well, it does take a while to heal. It's been months, you know. So you notice that sort of stuff, and so because of that, I think when you're younger, you're very brave about stuff, because you think you're going to shake everything off anyway. And being immortal, luckily, you're not going to be touched by any of this tragedy that seems to cripple everybody else, right? You know, you don't really
you're
know
immune to
why
it.
They're making such a fuss, frankly.
Right.
Come on.
Why is life difficult?
It's only life. Come on. Till it gets you.
And there's, so when I see, there's two ways I see, like there's a savviness to both the fact that these are really catchy tunes that you could relate to, and then decades later there's a lot of meaning in it. There's another thing, and we talked about this a little bit on the phone. The impression that looking at your band, at first English Beat, I mean, any time that basically you and Ranking Roger are seen in these videos, you mentioned that, like, it was almost a precursor to multicultural sort of bands in some ways, yeah? You know what?
Well, it turned out, I think, because of MTV, it ended up being an example to a lot of people of multiculturalism, just at a time when people were looking for icons of that sort of thing. And so me and Roger, being a bit exotic and being from England, which in American terms is kind of exotic, so it was all right to have a black friend if he was from England, and so was he, right?
That's funny.
But it was, so it, but I didn't realise that either until after I'd lived in America for a few years and people would comment about it. And then I put that together with the occasional spat, public or otherwise, that me and Roger seemed to have. And I had to tell him, I was like, no, you don't understand. We're like an example to other people. So singing about love and unity together, they actually believed it. So
they can't see us spatting.
So we have no choice but to, you know, so, we'd like to cancel that love and unity. You know that love and unity thing we said between everybody, everybody in the world? Well, that's except me and Roger. So I always thought that was a bit too ironic. I know life's ironic, but I thought that was a bit too much. And so I always hope that we can get together and sing, you know, Kumbaya and a couple of other songs if we get the chance.
Well, it did. It set a great example. It, and that's something that, you know, when you look at the videos, it really does. It was is ahead of its time in some ways. I don't know if you
Harry Belafonte and Petula Clark.
Oh, it'd be a nice...
on the Ed Sullivan Show. Did a Petula Clark... like, touch Harry Belafonte. Or, heaven forbid, I can't believe they would have edited it out if it was the other way around.
Right.
If Harry Belafonte wouldn't touch that white lady, would he?
That would be like, they'd do a cutaway.
They'd have to.
They'd have to.
It's a soap commercial. Wash your mouth. Wash the children's mouths out now. But I know, I think the nice white lady touched the black man's arm, didn't she? And it was a big deal.
Right, right.
Well, that's what it turned out. Me and Roger singing and dancing on the same stage and camera meant to a lot of people here in America. It was seen as, oh, it's okay to do that then.
Right. And it did. I mean, and now you look at the way things have evolved with hip-hop and stuff, but that was sort of before all of that had really even happened, you know, in a lot of cases. You know. And
so I caused all the white rappers.
Well, I'm giving.
Is that what you're doing?
No, I don't want to. Come on. I don't want to give you that. I don't know if that's blame or credit. When you put it like that,
there's no need for you to have brought it up.
But it has that sort of, you know, I don't know, that feel. And I wondered, when you think of, I mean, you were popular then with, and you still have this kind of quality when people like the Police, for example, or people like the Clash. They got something out of seeing you guys together. What did you get of being up close with those both of those bands at different points?
The Clash were like Paul Weller.
The Jam.
It didn't really matter what they did, even when they stopped doing it and were just standing around having a cigarette, complaining about how long it was taking, or they didn't know why they were doing it anyway. If somebody took a photograph of that moment, which they invariably did, it looked as though they were making a statement on behalf of a whole generation. Indiscernible, perhaps.
Right.
But every cigarette was a James Dean moment, you know, hanging around with the Clash. It was terrific, and it rubbed off on you. And you could turn your collar up and spit, so long as everybody wasn't watching. I never, like, wore a Levi jacket with the sleeves cut off to the waistcoat look, you know, the sort of punk Hell's Angel crossover. I never did that. No. Some of them did and did it well. I couldn't do
that. You were very sharp dressed.
But I got to stand by the side of the stage and I had my collar up and I spat and, yeah, you know what I mean? And and it was fantastic. You know, the revolution without a pamphlet.
Right. And you, what is your, did you have, was there any kind of lasting lessons from being with those cats early on? Was there something that you picked up from that at all? Or was it moving so quickly it was more just a great experience?
That even if things seemed surreal, even if things seemed really scary and potentially dangerous, if it felt right musically or stylistically, you were better off throwing yourself into the mouth of the lion. Make sure your collar was up, just in case anybody was taking a picture. It was better to do that than to try and be endlessly pragmatic. And in the face of uncertainty, the class showed us just to have unlimited courage and compassion, at least for their own predicament.
For dealing with them.
You know.
How about the police?
Almost the exact opposite. Almost the exact opposite. I'm so glad you asked. Everything as safe as it possibly could be. Locked down like one of those, the Monitor or the Merrimack, just about to battle in the waters outside Washington, D.C. Everything utterly secure and safe. Any opportunity for chaos routed out like subversives and have their fingers chopped off in football arenas.
They had it that much down to a routine.
Not them so much. Just everything that surrounded them was to give a semblance, a look of punk outrage incorporated.
Mm-hmm. Incorporated being the key phrase.
The absolute key. And so it was sad because Sting was obviously a talented songwriter and had quite a few things to say.
Sure.
And Andy was a, you know, had been a great guitarist for 45 years, so with John Mayall or Blues Breakers or, you know, different. He had a pedigree as a guitarist in England, didn't he? Long before any of us was in a group. And Stuart Copeland, well, he had plenty of energy. So it was a shame, but they were so controlled. They weren't allowed to say stuff in interviews. They weren't allowed to do anything that could be seen as being in any way controversial.
Or jeopardizing that carefully cultivated sort of image, I guess.
It was a shame, really, I thought. And you tended to think, like, because it appeared massive. In many ways, it appeared much, much bigger than The Clash at the time. You know, 15 trucks of lights just for a drum solo.
Right.
Whereas you wondered whether Topper was going to make the drum solo. Topper! Solo! Yeah, right. You know, so you were never quite sure with The Clash.
Is that how? Is that
more like watching a bullfight? This could go any way at any moment. You know, oh, he's dropped down. No, he did that on purpose. Did he just fall to one knee? Was that theatre?
Well, or is he hurt?
He seems to be spending a long time getting up. No, he does that. No, he is hurt. You're right. Oh, he's rolled over. Oh, that's not right. So there was that, which was great because it was more human, I thought, and because of that, then. It was funny. It was very funny, and there was a lot of tears of just absurd hilarity with The Clash, waiting desperately for soundcheck in Paris. Where are they? Well, they just found one of them. He was unconscious in a gutter in Montmartre. It's like, oh, how fabulous. How fabulous is that? Oh, God. You know, and you'd been trying your best to be fairly smart and talk as much of your schoolboy French as you could, but there they'd gone. Boom. Straight away.
To the gutter.
You know what I mean? Straight to the gutter, where, of course, as we know, only from the gutter can an artist have a true vision of the stars. And they, you know, so you couldn't compete with that. Whereas Sting would be all right with us most of the time. Gordon, even. But then when you'd get to a gig, it was like the whole thing backstage was a performance. And you'd try and say hello, and one of 15 burly security guys would suddenly smack into your shoulder and say, Mr. Sumner's reading a film script.
Wow.
And he would. He'd go walking through a crowd of people with a film script, like bait, like covering himself in blood and going swimming around sharks, you know. So people would come and try and speak to him and these people would pop him. Mr. Sumner's reading a script. weird.
Unbelievable. I can just picture it, though.
It's odd, but it set for a certain tension. But then when he had a moment...
He was friendly and nice?
Splendid chap. An English teacher.
He had to be the one who got you guys on that bill, yeah? It's hard to know.
Sometimes, huh? I mean, he liked Roger a lot as well, and Roger sang a bit of stuff. Bang biddly biddly bids with this place. Sometimes we thought they had them as the support bankers. We were quite willing and capable of ruining our commercial potential by gobbing off about any political thing that there wasn't.
On stage.
There wasn't a political issue that happened during that 4 years that we didn't have a strong opinion about, even the ones we knew nothing about. Whereas they were not allowed to say anything about anything. Till after the police.
Right, and then they became really... Right, they unloaded.
Sting, then you couldn't see him without an entourage of endangered peoples that he'd just saved that afternoon. Up until that point, what Amazon?
Right, that's interesting. It all became available to them afterwards. He wouldn't touch anything like that.
He wasn't... I don't know how could... Anyway, that was the plan, and it worked. I mean, they...
Famous. Was it your outwardness... In the way of being willing to take on causes or things that mattered to you or slam things that you thought weren't right, is that what led to you getting that role in the thing we talked about the other day, the alternative energy thing that you did? I mean, the record that had all these stars giving away all the dough.
It was a good confluence, you know, of just the timing and all. I could go to people who I'd done concerts with, the people from REM, mm-hmm. who'd been our opening band. Their first tour outside of Athens had been opening for the Beat. Other people that I'd worked with and say, if we pulled this benefit record off in a way that everybody looked good and nobody ever had a chance of looking stupid, I promise, would you be interested?
Is that the rap you'd use?
Yes.
Oh, that's cool.
And I promise to pull you out of it long before there's any stupid medals coming. Would you be interested? And they said yes. Well, they liked it, and it helped, you know. So it helped immediately, really, with REM and U2, who were already friends of Greenpeace anyway. But it helped, and so I could go then round record companies and... sold them on the general idea, a mobile solar generator.
You came up with that?
Yeah. Mobile solar generator, recording live concerts and...
That's dope.
Bro punch on the air there. And mixing it as well with... We ended up mastering the CD as well. Used the opportunity to use 100% post-consumer card.
Right.
Recycled card. 100% soy ink, I think the first.
And that 100% post-consumer is still revolutionary because it's still not really a common thing, and this was way back.
We just wanted to show, well, there are these things, and if just a little thing like Greenpeace can do this, what would happen if, like, governments...
Governments
took it on, like, seriously.
Wow, that is so cool, though.
So it was an idea, and... And then to go around the record companies and they'd say, well, yes, I mean, that's a good enough idea, Dave, but I mean, who have you got? And you go, well, REM and U2 to start with.
Oh, just a couple.
Sure, throw the letters of intent down. I mean, the letter of intent was loose enough, you know. It's like, if this is a really good idea, we're still in.
It was genius, but you thought of the mobile, the solar-powered mobile, too.
To try and do something the way of least resistance, which should be the way of survival anyway, eh? But the number of times being in a group yourself where somebody's got a great idea for a benefit, it's fantastic. Unfortunately, it means that you've got to all drive to Alaska
to do it
in May for a week. And there's no money for flights. And it all just becomes very tortuous. So this idea was, you don't have to do anything but be on tour.
We'll come.
We'll show up.
Nice.
And park a solar-powered exhibition about alternative renewable energies. There was still, you could use either at the time. And people could come and have a look at it, and we'll record a whole concert and give you the tapes. Or after the show, if you want to, you can mix the whole thing. or you can mix one song and give it us, or you can come back and mix one song, or you can just take the tape and thanks for thinking of us. Not many people chose that. A couple did.
And that's how you ended up with this incredible lineup.
It was a good record.
You're damn right it
smashing
was.
Smashing and
huge. Annie Lennox.
Yes, and a lot of nice things as well by record companies and publishers were sensitive to it. So by designating that these live versions of songs were actually different songs than
the original,
the studio ones that have been sometimes frankly played to death.
Right.
They played on the radio. DJs would play them instead of that regular one, and they created their own income stream, which everybody gave 100% of to Greenpeace for that. I don't know if it was in forever, but certainly for the duration of the major push of the release.
Right.
And then there'd been a previous Greenpeace record that had only just sort of joined in with Greenpeace on the tail end of it. And one of the bits was, it's still the record industry, isn't it? You know. They'd made more than they'd sold, you know. So the only way they could get like a tax break on them was they had to incinerate 40,000 records. Was there anything that we could do? And so thank heavens, found somebody who was a long-time supporter who was quite a big cheese at a record club as well. We developed a really darling relationship. And he took the 40,000. We saved them from the incinerator. Good grief, could you imagine that? Oh, Lord. But anyway, and they were given away, I think, as a special incentive or something like that on the record club. So we approached him again, and we did that right from the kickoff and got it as Christmas record. So it was feel good, solar power, brand new planets. The notion that the word ecology and economy both come from the same Greek word, ekos or oikos, the hearth, the center, the nurturing center of the household, in many ways, I suppose. And interesting that then that's exactly where we are now, isn't it?
Yeah.
That it makes economic sense to be
green,
ecologically
sound,
sensible.
Yeah, yeah.
Duh.
No doubt. You were so ahead of the curve. It was
have to be, though. It's not. There's nothing to be patted on the back. It was as obvious to everybody, but it's good to make a mark about it because it takes about 15 years for dead obvious things to become commonplace.
You're right, and make sense.
All of a sudden, you woke up as if you'd been in a deep freeze for 15 years and the election cycle had begun and the governator, John McCain and Giuliani are all visiting a solar power factory in California. I sit up in bed, I'm rubbing my eyes, I'm like, this is not happening.
I know.
This is not happening. And it was a bit like greenwash. Do you remember that? There was a push against people advertising environmentally when really all they'd done was coloured everything in green, you know? It was called greenwash. But I never minded it. I was like, well, so long as they're convincing other people that being green and being environmental is a good
idea. Using
it
for a good thing.
I don't care whether they're lying.
Right.
You know, if they're not telling their truth, that's on them. If they're convincing other people it's a good thing and it is, that's good. So, and I thought that. I was like, there's the governor, McCain, Giuliani, talking about renewable, alternative.
Energy.
American energy. It's like, and it was dead obvious for ages, wasn't it?
It totally was, and I know, I'm sure you've heard it before, but I mean, to hear you tell that story, it's even cooler that A, the bands all, that people knew you were so outspoken, you were a good guy to kind of lead the charge, if you will, with the record, and then to have the good sense to approach the bands, hey, I'm going to make it real easy for you, we're going to come to you, we're going to put this visible thing that you're going to be able to get some cred off of, and we're going to record it in a...
And without making them appear to be charity Charlies.
Right.
Because people get bothered.
Right, they don't. It doesn't look too cool to do that.
They just get bothered too much, don't they? So they have to try and be selective and make it look as though it's, you know, it's something effortless.
Yeah, you mean because a lot of people seek them out to do that kind of
they
stuff.
They really
what you,
do.
Is what you're
know,
saying.
So
yeah.
It's a shame. I could imagine that during the heat of it, well, probably still now, you two have probably got a couple of floors of staff dealing. I've got a great idea for a benefit.
Can you help us with this? Yeah, can you imagine?
90% of my work at Greenpeace was saying thanks, but no thanks.
I bet.
We've got this great idea for a benefit, and you'd like quickly run through it. You'd like, oh, good. So this is going to take me about 12 people working on this for about 3 months for nothing. If they break even, it's going to be a clear miracle. There better be a green goddess, because on paper this is, you know.
Or a pair of goddesses, if you were the Sheen man.
That doesn't seem to have done the trick, do you think?
It doesn't. It didn't save it.
Is it like a genie? Is he rubbing them the wrong way? There must be, is there something wrong with the technique or something?
Right.
That's not working, is it?
His technique. As I wrap it up with you, you've been very giving with your time, and there's a part of you that you said on the phone, which really...
Mercury surfboard, winning. Oh, I'm sorry.
You live in Cali, Southern California, and at some point, I don't know if it was there, but I know that that is where public radio is part of your life. When did you first transition or realize that public radio, public media was an outlet that you cared about? And what are some of the things that you listened to there?
Well, the first time really was driving after gigs. You know, so you probably get out of some clubs 2 o'clock, maybe a bit later. And you've got the radio on, driving up and down the length of California, and like all of a sudden, this is the news coming to you in the World Service. And it's like, what? The haunting strains of Lily O'Leary.
It was the BBC.
Hello, coming to you on the BBC. And I thought that was great because I grew up on the BBC News. And I didn't go for the full notion that it was the only pure news and everything else was propaganda. But you can check back on stuff. You know, all news is verifiable, isn't it? And you can check back on what angles the BBC push. And there's a slant sometimes, but it's but they do go back, and you do hear what happened with that story 2 weeks later. It's not just it's not just, oh, there's a helicopter crash, and guess what? There's probably gonna be another one tomorrow somewhere else. Tune in at 12, and we'll let you know where there's a helicopter crashed, and you never hear about the one that crashed today. But with the BBC News, sometimes, you know, it's a bit too much. But the follow-up, it's like, all right, you know.
We heard enough the first time.
8 years later, you know, we met 4 young Pakistani girls, you know, and it's like, right. Oh, God.
They relive the whole.
We're back to the village, and you know, it's like, gosh. But, I mean, it's good because it shows a continuity of stories and stuff. So I did enjoy that, and I enjoy very much how news can sometimes break on the World Service because it's just happened. And it gets thrown out there a bit raw. And nobody's spun it like a plate yet on one of those long sticks.
Out.
No, yeah, nobody's given it direction, groomed it.
Massaged it.
Yes, that's right. We're just making the message a bit more obvious, Dave, that's all. You know? And so it's like raw milk, I suppose. So I enjoy it. And then it's nice that you can watch then. On the radio and the television overnight and start switching from channel to channel, see them pick up on a story, see where the spin starts to go, see which way people start to spin the plate on the long stick, see which way they think it's going to be able to sell by daybreak. And you can have this fun driving home in the van, the length of California, watching the sun come up and watching the spin get set on the news, you know.
So it was really hearing that BBC, the familiarity of it.
The start of that, yes. And then you start All Things Considered, you know, and you're like, well, it would be nice to consider all things because we consider so few of them so often. So few things considered so often by so many to the detriment of all. And so it's nice to hear things considered a bit more in depth and a bit more often. And... And then I heard an advert, in that in the interminable fundraising week. I know we've got to hurry you on this because we've only got a minute and 56 seconds left now. I need 4 more premium listeners. Four more Edwards Angels is what I'm looking for now. Who join us at the $10 to $12.50 level. And I've got a yellow coffee mug here. Listen, Wookie. Just join. You've got a minute 30. I hated all that. I was like, oh, God. And it's terrific information, but it seems so craven. It's like, oh, Lord, the world must be in such an awful place that people just trying to tell you actually what's going on have to prostrate have to themselves like this, you know.
The funds.
It's worse than a Tibetan prostration, and you've got nothing on your hands and knees, you know, nothing to – and I thought there's got to be better ways to do it, you know. But this English lady said that she'd been in America only a few months.
Right.
And she'd realised that whoever pays for the news gets to dictate what's in it. And although I'd been in America for a few years, I'd never fully understood it and appreciated it as clearly as that. I just switched channels to try and get a balance
right.
of views so I could steer my way down the middle. But I'd never thought of it as cut and dried as that, as, you know, whoever pays for the news tells you what's happened. Oh. Yes, I suppose so.
Right, you become the guy who's paying for the news.
So, yes. Yeah, so
takes the spin.
Yes, public, you know, subscription, you know, although we're still looking for a way of, and it's now there's less than a minute 56 seconds. It's probably less than, I've got 5 seconds, Dave, and I've got three. We've got one more, and somebody in Baltimore is going to match it. But here we go. Yes, thank you, Darlene. And you're just making up people to pretend that somebody's joined to give the next presenter some chance, you know,
some juice to get started.
We pretended with. You know, we just pretended we've made four more VIP listeners, non-existent, like a Dutch auction, picking them off the wall. Thank you, hands in Anaheim, $150, you know.
Is that what it's like listening to the KCRW one?
All of them. We listen to them all over the country, and it's some of them get really horribly personal, don't they?
Right.
You know, when they
make you feel guilty.
Well, they have a sort of guest presenter who comes in and feels like they're allowed to go a bit further.
Right. They can ride herd on you a little bit more.
the guy that's there. Come on, what are you going to do for this guy? He's here every week. He hardly makes anything. It's horrible.
I'm thinking we should have Dave come in to do our guest thing.
He'd I've got a better idea. We should do it at concerts. I was lucky enough to be part of this Greenpeace tabling thing. And I think we should do it for NPR, really, or public radio, because there's a few. Yes, you see, there's a lot of different public radios, isn't there? And this is where I got into tricky waters, because some places there's competing public radios in the same area.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought you should have a table at concerts, much like we used to have a Greenpeace table or all sorts of different tables, giving out information, signing up people, and we could spare people that on the airwaves then a bit, because that notion of where you get your information from and who pays for it dictates the kind of purity of the information.
Sure, absolutely.
Especially in the, what is it, a blessing and a curse to be born in interesting times. So they say. That's
a good way of putting it.
Well, it's a Chinese proverb, not mine. I wish it was.
It still sounds good when
it
you
does,
say
it. You know, and something we should learn, else we would all be learning how to sing Auld Lang Syne in Chinese. We have a clear option, don't we? You know?
We do. They can become the world banker, or we can get it together.
That's fantastic. I would be quite good. It's like the biggest debtor. Oh, here he comes again. Could I borrow a bit more? You know that money I owe you? Well, can I borrow a bit more of it again? And I'll pay you on Friday.
No shit. This goes on and on.
Yeah, we'd be the teenage kid, wouldn't we? Fantastic.
That's a great idea, and I'm glad that you share that. We talked about that the other day, and I think it's a wonderful idea.
The percentage of something you could probably...
Right.
Because there's a lot of C3 charity edges to it, isn't there? And so there's probably a way that you could donate a small percentage of the proceeds of the concert or the T-shirts, or the promoter could do the same. And you could probably generate outreach, interest, and funds.
I think it's a great thing. I think it's a great idea. And it was a privilege that you shared it with me the other day, and I'm glad you shared it with me right here in the building. Because
it should start right here, right now. And we have a mate.
Anyone, we have our table. This could be our
first
table.
This is the round table here.
We've begun.
The only thing is, you know, it's a bit of a sacrifice, Dave, but I'm going to have to come to Hawaii a bit more often. keep an eye on this fledgling project.
I think it's a
But I'm willing to do it.
It's a give and take.
For the people, mate. Right. Sometimes you've got to sacrifice. You
got to do it for the mate.
You know. So, yes, I think it would be good. I think there's lots of people who would be interested. I bet you find there's loads of groups who
would listen. Be approachable to
you. And an odd... when I first became interested in public radio, it was mainly talk radio that I got to hear. Now, I should say the majority of the stations that play my music in some sort of eclectic oldies format also tend to be public radio.
You've made the transition.
Well, only two things rise to the top, Dave, the cream and the scum, which are we. You know, that's public radio. Compassion and community. I've got all the adverts ready to go for this, Dave. We could roll this out.
I think it's sounding very good. Hey, you're a solid brother.
Thank you, sir. And thank you very much for having me.
I hope sometime we can hang in California if I'm out there. And anytime you're out here, you better look me up, brother.
Well, let's launch this project. I think it would be worthwhile, and I think we'd find there's lots of people who would be interested in doing it. It would generate funds and interest quite quickly, I think.
You've done it throughout your life, so the fact that you still are thinking like that now is a great thing. I mean, I applaud you for being able to do that. It's inspirational. So I'd love that. You know, it's a great idea.
And I'll work on my radio voice. It's not as resonant as yours, is it?
No, it's a great radio
voice.
You like that, huh?
Yeah, I like that.
My very special guest, Dave Wakeling, and it's been a great pleasure having you here again.
Do the pantyhose help with that voice? So you just wear that for that.
I do that because you were coming over.
Oh, okay. I liked it. Nice touch. You don't see that color pink very often. No, very 80s.
Well, and you, 80s. When you have Dave Wakeling English speech and a public, you want to do it that
little
way.
Special. Thank you. I appreciate this. You know.